So yes, I come from television. It can be as described, but I've maybe had slightly more kind of magical experience in television, and hence have been in it for 13 years. And indeed, I've worked on 2,500 episodes of continuing drama, which I absolutely love. But I'm not going to talk today about the mechanics of storytelling. There's plenty of people that do that very well. I want to talk, I mean, storytelling is about journeys, of course, which is why it's a great theme of today to talk about journeys, but I want to talk about my journey into becoming a storyteller for television and how storytelling in television is changing. We are hardwired for story as a species. We are a storytelling animal, and that's because our brain uses story to make sense of the world that we're in. Lisa Gronn writes about it in her book, Wired for Story. You know, from birth, our brains sort of goals to make causal connections, if this, then that. And what we do with stories, we use stories to seek meaning in life. We use it to anticipate danger, tell stories that can make us kind of anticipate things in the world. It helps us to seek meaning, to establish a moral code. That's what fairy tales are for when you're a child. Story entertains us. It makes us maybe feel less alone. There's a primal need for story that has been there since we were cavemen sitting around a campfire. And because we think in story terms, that's why storytelling has such a compulsive hold over us. Now, the mechanisms for storytelling have evolved over the years, but the need is still there. But all of this, or you know, kind of neurological way of looking at story is very dry. For me, story is also a very, very magical thing. And there's a great quote from Salman Rushdie in his book, about Harun and the Sea of Stories. And this book is about kind of, or Salman Rushdie's kind of exile during this experience he went through. But what I love about this book is it kind of celebrates the magical nature of storytelling. So Harun the hero at this point in the book sees the sea of stories for the first time. I'm just going to read it out. He looks at the sea and sees thousands and thousands of currents, each one in a different colour, weaving in and out of one another like a liquid tapestry of breathtaking complexity. The ocean that streams the story was much more than a storeroom of yarns. It was not dead but alive. Now what I love about that is that storytelling is indeed a living and breathing thing. It evolves and changes with us. How we tell the stories of our lives is a living thing. Now, my sort of journey into becoming a storyteller was shaped by two sort of significant things in my childhood. The first thing was that my parents moved us all as a family to the north of Scotland to go live the good life. Literally. They were inspired by Tom Wilder's life of self-sufficiency and wanted to emulate it. So for as long as I can remember, I've been aware of the power of television to inspire. And sort of more prosaically, where they moved us to was this village that was 70 miles from the nearest theatre or cinema, and so television was my window into other worlds. The second thing that kind of led me to be a storyteller was having a difficult time at high school. I was kind of dumped by friends that I had, and I found myself very alone and outcast. And whilst I made new friends, I'd taken a huge knock to my self-esteem and retreated into myself. I became quite shy. Now, I've always been a sort of daydreamer of stories, but now I started to write in earnest because the characters I wrote about could behave in ways that I couldn't do in real life, that I didn't have the confidence to do. The world that I wrote about was just, whereas the real world, the high school world, often felt quite unjust and unfair. I saw writing for television as a way of having a voice. I was simply just a shy girl wanting to be heard. Now, of course, that was in the time of 4 TV channels and no internet. Maybe things would be different now. Maybe I'd take a different path because we have such an ease in which we can create media and get our story out there. Twitter and Facebook, for example. I'll take the example of Charlie Morgan, the ball boy for Swansea, recently hit the headlines. Now, he obviously was on his Twitter for however long he was on it, tweeting things that, you know, he was just doing it for his friends, probably. But when he hit the headlines, journalists used this to tell the story of his life. And I couldn't actually find it, but there was one tweet that he did where he said he was going to, you know, tonight's the night for time wasting in the football match. He was this bit in therapy and they asked him if it all happened. So when we tweet and we make status updates, we are telling the story of our lives. But if I'd done that when I was a kid, if I'd, you know, called my aunt on Facebook, would that have made me a good storyteller? I don't think so. Working in soap has been the best training ground for me to become a storyteller for television. You know, a soap story is an engine room. It's a really hard environment. You know, before I went into that, I used to kind of have a fear of a blank page of starting something because what if nothing came? Well, in soap you have endless deadlines that are daily, you have demands upon you, you have to get on the You have to learn how to take hard edits, you know, subjective notes. What you learn is that all sort of storytelling is subjective. You might write something you're really proud of, but someone will come along and it's seen in your way, change it, and you just have to start again. But you get very tough and robust about your voice as a writer and being able to write on demand. You learn how to articulate your instincts about a story. I mean, I don't know how many writers are in the room, but if you've ever been edited with nebulous notes, you know it's incredibly frustrating when someone says, you know, this is just a bit flat, or can it be funnier? They mean nothing, they don't help you improve your work. And so when you start a story off, you learn the value of a constructive note that really clearly tells you how to make your work better. But mainly what sort of story office does is it teaches you to become a master of the endless what if. What if this story goes this way, what if it goes another? You have to be able to continually come up with new ideas to keep yourself alive. But working in soap took me down a very surprising path, because I'd gone into television and wanted to be a writer. I have a writer's personality. But I found that I wanted to be a producer. And that's because in soap and in long-running drama, it's the producers that truly author the show. Now, writers, obviously there are all writing teams on these shows, but it is a producer who is able to shape the entire narrative, to make sure from beginning to end that the central creative vision is truly realised. And that's because even at the end of the process, in the director's edit, with the fine-cut viewing, the shots that you choose and actors' reaction to the line of dialogue can fundamentally change the meaning of the scene, and therefore the story. There's just now simply too many episodes and too big an infrastructure for the writers to truly author that right way through the process. Now that's fine if you're a creative producer and you understand the story. If you're a technical producer on one of those shows, what tends to happen is that the vision for that show falls to people around you. It becomes sort of by committee, by different departments who perhaps pull in different directions. And that's sometimes why these shows seem to sort of lose their identity. You can watch them and feel that something's not quite right because there's not a central vision behind them. In America, of course, they have showrunners who are writers, and in some short-form drama in this country, writers are getting to become execs on their shows, which is fantastic, but there isn't the infrastructure in high-volume shows to do that. Now, if you're wondering why, you know, you can be a sort of non-creative, non-story person and end up running one of these shows, it's because in television, unfortunately, often sort of personality and confidence is respected more than talent. Your television celebrates the extroverts rather than the introverts off-screen as well as on. And therefore, clearly, my problem in wanting to be a producer was that I was still shy. I was in my mid-20s, but I'd never had to really push myself and look at my personality and try and work past my shyness. And I even had a boss at the time when I said to him what I wanted to do, so he said to me, I don't think you've got the personality to be a producer. So becoming a producer was a really huge personal challenge for me. You know, it made me look at an aspect of my personality that I felt quite ashamed of. For me, shyness equaled weakness, and I didn't like that. I didn't see myself as weak, but I knew that's how people perceived me. I'd always really trusted my instincts on story, I knew how to do that, and I was good at my job. But being a producer meant I had to project myself forward, I had to kind of put me in the foreground, and I found that very uncomfortable. And so I went for voice coaching, I went for hypnotherapy for confidence. I mean, I still struggle with public speaking. This is kind of like hell to me, but I love what I do, so that's why I'm here. But I really had to work hard and try and sort of challenge these aspects of my personality. And the interesting thing is for me that at that time, I kind of thought that was really important, that I had to change in order to become successful. I had to become something other than me in order to really do my job well. But what I've learned since my first producing gig at Emmerdale is that actually a lot of what I've got in my personality is a huge strength. Because I have a writer's personality means I can connect with writers. I understand how incredibly vulnerable it is to put your work out there, to kind of offer yourself up to what you write. We put something of ourselves on that page, and therefore, you know, you need to treat it with respect and kindness. I think that, you know, being the kind of personality I am, I very much understand that the importance of a creative, trusted environment. You know, I have empathy, I'm not really led by my ego, so I don't want people to disagree with me, I want to encourage debate. And my favourite time when I write during a story conference is when writers start to argue with each other. Because if people are arguing, it means they're passionate about what they want to tell, and all great stories come from passion. In television, and it's probably linked back into the thing before about TV movies, it's in a difficult place to work, it's because there's an awful lot of politics. And I like to encourage an environment where people are working on their instincts and they're not thinking about politics. Nothing kills creativity quicker than thinking your job future depends on the person you agree with in the room. And I've been there, I know what that's like. I'm the first to admit to my mistakes because we all make them. And if you're not in an environment where mistakes can happen, then you're not in an environment where you're taking risks. If you're not taking risks in drama, you might as well give up now. It's got to be a place where we're trying new things. Now, the reason all of that is important, the reason creativity is so key, and the lack of it at times in this industry is a problem, is that television is about to enter its most challenging time yet. So, the 2012 Olympics brought about a change in viewing habits that is going to be incredibly significant going forward for this country. 30% of the new red button of users were new. 28% of viewers on mobile devices were doing it for the first time. And 2.7 million people during screening were doing so for the first time. Once you demystify seeking content out in this way, there is no going back. And it led to 2.3 billion IPO requests since 2012. I mean, that's absolutely incredible. It's something like double up in 2010. Now, what's happening is that companies such as Hulu, Amazon, and Netflix, they're recognising that they need to be more than content distributors, they need to be content creators as well. And that's because our world as viewers is very much about the programme and not the channel from which we see it. For me, I'm a follower of Mad Men wherever it goes. I love our show and I don't care what channel it's on, I will always seek it out. Now, last week, Ted Sarandon's Netflix was quoted to say that their goal is to become HBO quicker and faster than HBO can become us. They know that they've got to create great content to keep you, the viewer, watching on their particular content distributors. And there's also going to be sort of new funding in television as well. Sky, for the very first time, have offered a day pass for Sky Sports. It's the first time they've gone outside of their monthly subscription model because they're recognising that a sport being a kind of once, you know, you've got to see it on that day, is a great way for them to sort of harness some of this kind of disparate view and allow people to watch their channels. Obviously, the way that scheduling has changed is going to change ratings. And I'm sure all of you have seen recently sort of maybe in the last year in newspapers, especially around Christmas, the talk of how the overnight ratings were a certain amount, but a week later the consolidated ratings meant that Downton or other shows increased by 2 or 3 million. And that's because we'll record it or watch it on iPlayer. Television is going to have to find a new way of measuring the success of a TV show because the overnights are no longer a great indicator of what your audience is. So whilst TV is going to sort of survive, calling it TV as a programme, calling it TV is going to become quite anachronistic. And this is going to change how we tell stories. On services such as Netflix, rather than you know, you're going to get a whole series delivered to you at once. What Reed Hastings of Netflix calls it is managed dissatisfaction, the traditional scheduling model of waiting week to week to see your series. And what that does, that kind of scheduling pattern for drama, it makes us do certain narrative tricks in terms of how we tell our stories. We sometimes have very artificial cliffhangers, and I'm sure you all know the type I mean, where an episode will end on a shock or a revelation, and that's it, the credits roll. And when we come back to the next episode, you know, some time has passed, maybe a day, maybe a couple of days, and we have to pretend the characters haven't talked about what happened in the meantime, so something of the reaction to the revelation can be played out. That's very artificial, it's not very real. The real drama came in the moment the credit rolled and no one got to see it. And whilst that type of cliffhanger is quieter, it's more authentic, it's more powerful. And more character-led. So I think in the future, we're going to have a lot more shows that trust you, the viewer, and your engagement with the show, your engagement with the characters. Trust that you will remember what you've just seen. I mean, right now in a lot of dramas, you get very clunky catch-up scenes, just to make sure you know where you are. There's a fear that if you're a bit confused, you're going to turn off. So we put these little devices in there to keep you informed and make sure you stay with us. But if you're going to sit down on Netflix and watch, you know, 13 episodes, we can trust that you're going to keep up with it. And I think it's going to get more sort of sophisticated drama. obviously it's soaps and high long-running dramas, because they're high volume, they can't possibly deliver an entire series down to Netflix. I think we'll always want to have the high volume shows that we all watch together. I think there'll always be an audience for that, and soaps are very traditional in our habit of TV viewing, but they're going to have to really keep on top of the quality to make sure that we continue to seek it out in amongst increasing competition. TV is going to have to keep creativity and talent at its heart. Long-running shows are going to have to, it'll be factory lines for the productivity, but we're going to have to make sure they're good because the competition has never been stronger. With technology, it's not just the way we watch TV that's going to change, it's also about the way we interact with it. So with tweets, at peak time, 40% of the tweets are about a TV show, and if you have a mobile device, about 80% of people are on that sort of second screen device while watching television, with 50% engaged with the TV show, talking about the TV show. And ZBox kind of really uses this. ZBox is an app that it's about program information, it's about social networking, and it's also about targeted advertising. And they want to move towards more audience participation as well. And I'm also working with writers on trying to evolve the sort of storytelling narrative in television. Television is a third-person passive medium, whereas something like gaming is first-person, it's active. And I want to try and find a way of bringing that gaming narrative into television. You know, marketeers understand this. Marketeers are working on story worlds, not just storylines. They want you to be active in what they're doing, because if you're actively involved, if you're emotionally connected to it, you will kind of engage with it, it'll have an impact upon you and want to share it. I'm very lucky that at the moment I've got a thing called the Digital Fiction Factory, who are working with content creators in digital space to bring about a new, the next generation of storytelling. But about 6 years ago in Emmerdale, we did Who Feels on Game and Adult Online Channel. Now this was really ahead of its time. It was just about the time when people started to get broadband, it was pre-social networking. And it was around the murder mystery storyline of the house screen. And while the storyline ran on screen, we allowed the viewers to go online and hunt for clues and build up a world of looking for clues and playing narrative-based games. It enabled the viewers to kind of go off and talk about the murder mystery in an online space. So I'll show you things like the angel there, sort of corner, you clicked on that, you went to the graveyard, with the wall pack, you clicked on the front door, you went inside, you clicked on the shutter, it talks to you, offer you a clue, or offer you a hint as a way to find the clue. We had a suspect gallery where you could go to see who was the most likely to be murdered that week, and clues that could be found around the village. And this was the last undertaking for the programme. We worked with an Australian company called Problem and IT Digital. It was absolutely huge. We had new content uploaded with every single episode that was transmitted. This is where we input clues. It was legal. And narrative games. But there was so much more that we could do now. We have the most incredible amount of new technologies coming out to us. We have apps with interactive websites, Loom Room, Kinetic, audio watermarking, augmented reality, artificial intelligence. We have incredible new televisions coming out, 4K and 8K, that are kind of, you know, the next generation of HD. All these amazing kind of new technologies are going to mean that the way that we can create the story worlds around you, the viewer, are going to be incredible. So my journey to become a storyteller has also been a journey through technology as well, and I'm kind of glad that I started out with three TV channels. My very first sort of game, which was kind of connected to a TV, it wasn't a computer game as such. And this was the first computer game I ever played on a live computer. There was no graphics, it was all web-based. But what I love about having come from that is I understand the magic and the power of what we've got now. It all does come back to the same primal need as always that we've ever had. This, looking at that, seems anachronistic as talking about stories around a campfire compared to going to the cinema. But at the end of the day, you know, the need that was then as cavemen, the need that we have now hasn't changed. So back as a teenager, I was white because I want to have a voice. I'm just a shy girl, I want to be heard. And there's this really wonderful quote from Maya Angelou about storytelling. There's no hiding out there an untold story inside of you. And I think the new technologies coming forward in the future normally